Welcome, everyone. Bright and early. Thank you so much for making it. All right, so I am Ravi Shah. I am responsible for identity-related products at Google Cloud. And today, we're going to cover a lot of things related to identity and access management, with, of course, having identity sort of as the foundation of that stack and, of course, as the foundation of the entire Google Cloud security. So with that, let's get to it. We have four of us here, myself, Ravi, as I mentioned, and I have with my colleague with me, my colleagues here, Alok, Matthew and Elhadi are from L'Oreal, and they will also share with you how actually they are using the capabilities of Google Cloud to build some really cool analytics capabilities for L'Oreal. So with that, kind of starting from where Abhishek left off yesterday, this is the full stack IAM that is part of Google Cloud. We have Identity Fabric at the bottom, covering workforce identity, workload identity. Basically, workforce is the human identity, workload is the machine identity, and then we have customer identity, basically our CIAM product that is part of the Identity Fabric as well. And then there are other parts of the stack on top of it for policy and access control, and some scenario-based capabilities that we have for ITDR, fraud prevention, and others. So Alok will cover the policy piece as we go forward. I'm gonna focus right here on the identity side of things and really give you a view of our workforce and workload capabilities, and we'll briefly touch on the customer identity as well. So with that, I wanna start off with workload identity. Workload identity, as I said, is about sort of the machine identities. And really, the workload identities cover sort of two scenarios. One is the scenario in which the workloads actually access Google Cloud APIs. So if you're trying to access a BigQuery API, if you're trying to access Cloud Storage API, that's scenario number one. And the second scenario is a workload-to-workload communication, where you have, say, a microservice taking orders on your side, and the other one, the other microservice, which is, say, managing inventory. So you have two workloads, they're talking to each other. This is another scenario, and we want to make sure that there's secure communication between workloads as well. So both the scenarios we really focus a lot on, and we want to make sure that you have secure communication in each of these scenarios, and you have really great experience as you're trying to build your capabilities around these two scenarios. As it stands today, essentially, we have multiple kinds of capabilities that really power these two scenarios. On the scenario number one, where workload is trying to access GCP APIs, we have service accounts. Essentially, I'm sure you all know service accounts fairly well. They've been one of the sort of long-standing pillars of Google Cloud, and they cover essentially all the compute platforms. And then we have workload identity federation, where if you have workloads on other clouds or on-premises, and those workloads are trying to access APIs on Google Cloud, then you can do identity federation and securely essentially connect those workloads to the GCP APIs. And both these scenarios are part of it. Both these capabilities are part of our capability that allows you to connect to GCP APIs. And then we have authentication to other workloads, mesh, service mesh. There was a session, I believe, yesterday on that as well. Mesh identity is a key part of that. And it covers essentially GKE platform, and it's a pretty robust capability that we have as well. We continue to evolve, essentially, our service accounts, our workload identity federation, service mesh capabilities. We really focus a lot on making sure that the capabilities that you're using, that are core part of the platform, like service accounts, We are continuing to innovate on that because we know that that's deeply ingrained in your stack, and it's important for us to make sure that you have great experience with that. I'm sure you all have seen sort of, or at least have seen the need of identifying when service account keys are leaked on, say, your GitHub repository in the public. And you want to make sure that nothing actually makes it in the public, even by mistake. Mistakes happen, right? And so how do you control that? How do you make sure that there is no damage because of any accidental leaks in the public? So we have implemented this feature which immediately detects the leakage of any service account key, and it will disable that key. That happens through an org policy. I'll show a quick demo about that as well. It's a pretty cool feature because as soon as the key is detected as leaked on GitHub or any other public repository, essentially what we'll do is we'll disable the key, and it will make sure that your key is or your workloads are protected. Also, we have heard a lot of need for easy grouping of service accounts. Say you want to group a number of service accounts as production or test or staging, and you want to provide certain access control around for those service accounts. We can now do that using service account tags. And lastly, I know many of you use GKE workload identity, which is basically the KSA, if you will, the Kubernetes service accounts, and you map it to the Google service accounts, and there's a lot of work that happens essentially to make the service accounts from your GKE work with essentially service accounts on Google Cloud, tie it together, and essentially give access to your GKE, to your APIs. We have done some great work there, which actually simplifies the experience, so I'll talk a little bit about that. So now, let's look at this quick demo about detection of service account key leaks, right? So in this demo, essentially you'll see that how you can create an org policy that configures your system to say whenever a key is leaked, you basically disable that key. So what I'm going through here in this scenario is essentially the configuration of the org policy. And what's happening is that whenever in this configuration, whenever the service account key is essentially detected as leaked, we have given the configuration that says disable that key, right? So here's the service account, the org policy creation that's happening right now. And now you're seeing that the service account is being accessed, the key is being created, and private key is saved to the computer. Now the key is actually going to be exposed on say GitHub, right? And here you go, the key is now exposed on GitHub, say by mistake, and now you'll see essentially that the key is actually going to be disabled right here, as you see here. So as soon as the key is actually leaked, it's detected and it's disabled, protecting your workloads. So pretty cool capability, and it will make sure that you don't have any accidental leaks for service account keys. Now, moving on, this is the second demo I want to show you around grouping of service accounts. So we have implemented this feature called service account tagging, and you can tag service accounts with, say, prod, staging, test, or whatnot, and you can create policies around those tags. So in this example, we are creating a deny policy for service accounts that matches the tag as prod, right? So if a service account has a prod tag, essentially what it's saying is that create a deny the key creation on any service account which is tagged as prod, because you want to make sure that you don't allow that key creation. It's a key threat vector potentially. So the deny policy is now created, and it's being bound to the service accounts which are marked as prod. And now you will see that I'm going to go in the service account page and try to create a key for this service account, and I'm going to get an error because we have denied the creation of service account keys for these kinds of service accounts. So again, a nice protection that you could enable and make sure that any grouping of service accounts follows a certain set of policies that you want to apply on those service accounts. Now, the last one is simpler workload federation experience for GKE. So you no longer need service account impersonation for the GKE workload identities. So I'm showing you here the before scenario and the after scenario. In the before scenario, meaning what used to happen is you would create Kubernetes namespace and service accounts, and you would bind it to essentially a Google service account. And then you will configure the KSA to impersonate GSA, and then annotate the KSA with GSA so that GKE knows essentially the bidirectional link between KSA and GSA. Now we have simplified that experience significantly. You go ahead and create Kubernetes namespace and service accounts, and then you can bind the roles essentially directly to the GSA, and things will just work. So you don't have to configure this bidirectional, essentially, configuration of KSA should know GSA, GSA should know KSA, all that messes, all that capability is not needed anymore. Your experience would be much, much more seamless with this solution. Now, as I said, service accounts is deeply embedded in your stack today, and we want to make sure we innovate there. But we don't want to stop there. We want to take the workload identity capabilities to the next level and continue to evolve that into a much stronger framework for workload identities. And that is what we call managed workload identity. What it is, it's a unified identity across all environments. So like you saw in my previous picture, there was service account, there was GKE workload identity, there was mesh identity. We want to simplify all of that under one umbrella and call it managed workload identity. It's a certificate-based identity, cryptographic identity, essentially, with strong lifecycle management, and it's based on SPIFFI standard. So a unified identity that will make sure your life is much, much easier as you try to connect workloads on different compute environments, whether those workloads are, again, connecting to GCP APIs or whether those workloads are connecting to other workloads. So you'll have a consistent managed workload identity kind of interface, and then you'll have support for all the compute runtimes, and you will also have support for federation to other clouds or on-premises and whatnot. So this is a key innovation area. You're going to see lots of announcements from us in this area in coming days. Now, moving on to workforce identity, Abhishek in his session yesterday, if any of you attended there, talked about how we want to give options to you around what kind of workforce identity you use. Cloud identity is the native identity of Google Cloud. Identity federation is where you can essentially bring identities from your third-party systems and use that to access GCP. And in the mixed mode, essentially what you can do is some of your identities are cloud identities, native identities, some of your identities are federated identities. So you can use both together as well if you want it so. I'm gonna quickly take you to scenarios for that are best suited for cloud identity. They are when you need a native identity on Google Cloud, you choose cloud identity. When you want separation of admin control from like IdP admin and cloud admin, then you use cloud identity because you don't want the same administrator to have control over both identities. And when you want common identity, for example, across GCP and workspace, that's when you use cloud identity. Identity federation, just to reiterate what it is basically it is going to connect your identity provider to our APIs through essentially a token service that is in between. It will make sure token is exchanged, and the same identities that you have in your IDP are available for you to access all the Google Cloud APIs. It allows you to use your existing identity investments, and no identity provisioning is required for this scenario. This is great when you want to have consistent SSO experience across all the apps, including Google Cloud. When you want to onboard new identities to your cloud deployment and you don't want to essentially go through the exercise of syncing, et cetera, you can actually use federated identities. And if you want to make sure that your entire compliance is happening on the IdP side, one-stop shop, then you use essentially federated identities. But as I said, cloud identity and federated identities, they are sort of two extremes, if you will, but you can use both of them together as well. Let me just quickly go through this slide. Where you can have some of your identities as cloud identities and some of your identities as federated identities. For example, if you have a contractor who you want to give access to certain GCS buckets, and you don't want essentially to have to sync their identities onto the platform, you basically just go through the mixed mode. You're like, okay, fine, I have most of my identities as cloud identities. Some of them I'm going to federate, but that's a mixed mode that is supported, so I can just keep going that way. So mixed mode is one of the most common scenarios that we are seeing, especially if you are already deeply ingrained in cloud identity. But if you're starting fresh, or especially starting fresh on certain segments, then you make sure that you definitely consider federated identities as well. That's kind of the lay of the land in terms of workforce identities. And the last thing I want to touch on is our customer identity product. We have a capability for customer identity access management, CIAM, as some of you may actually be using that. And we continue to innovate in this space and make sure that you have some of the best capabilities here. So I'm going to quickly enlist a few. There is a whole host of capabilities actually around these that goes beyond these, but these are new features that we have released in last 6 months or so, or are going to be coming soon in the next 30 days or so. So number one, SMS region controls for abuse protection. So for example, if you know that you don't have users in, say, Russia, you don't want to be essentially sending SMSs to that region, right? That's basically probably somebody abusing the system. So you can have some region controls and make sure that those SMSs are not going out, and essentially you're controlling your cost. We have integrated our CIAM with ReCAPTCHA, which many of you may know is a fraud prevention product. And we have made sure that the email password flows are tightly integrated with ReCAPTCHA as well, so that again, you can avoid fraud on your site. And lastly, we continue to sort of move towards the passwordless world. We continue to innovate in this space, and we have implemented passkey solution to sign in the end users. There's a lot more to these things, and I'm happy to sort of take your questions after this about any of these capabilities. So, but wanted to quickly highlight some of the key things that we are doing in this area as our sort of commitment to make sure we are taking you to the best place. We are ensuring that you have great capabilities on Google Cloud. So with that, this ends sort of the identity section of the stack. I have with me Alok here, who's going to talk you through the access policies. Alok.
Thank you, Ravi. Ravi gave us some good updates on an identity space. And let's go back to the stack that we talked about and move to the next layer. Identity and access controls go hand in hand to protect your corporate resources. An access policy can not only keep your unwanted users and hackers out of your system, it also enables your users to get the right permissions to do their job. And those users could be your employees in your organization, they could be part of the contractor or the vendors that you work with, and you can enable those scenarios using the federated identities we just talked about, as the federated identities work seamlessly with our access policy controls. Before we go further, let's do a quick recap on our identity-centric policy controls. As an admin, you manage cloud resources, you have identities across, and you're required to give access to your employees. The first and the foremost is an allow policy. A very simple policy. You can say, on this resource, give these permissions for these users. Once you do that, people can start accessing resources. Next, what we call is a deny policy. Exact opposite, on this resource, deny these permissions for these users. But deny policies are applied at a much broader level. They act more like a guardrails. You can take an example here. Say, deny policy, deny access to everybody in your company to a finance folder, except users in the group called finance team. Even if you leak an access to a folder in a finance department, nobody's gonna go access it, because whenever there is a conflict on a resource, there's an allow policy and a deny policy, deny wins. So these are very potent guardrails to help you protect your resources. Now, besides insider risks that you talked about, you also need to protect against external threats. Imagine a scenario where a similar sounding company, just watch out for the names on the two sides, creates some storage bucket, give access to your employees, hoping they make a mistake and copy the data onto their site. And they call it a phishing attack. You can also think of it like an insider risk where it's a disgruntled employee and copy data from your inside the organization to another organization. At this Cloud Next, we are announcing a new policy control, which we call as a principal access boundary, or PAB, that lets you create a perimeter around the resources that an identity is allowed to access. I want to emphasize this does not allow or deny access. It merely limits the extent of an access. You will still need allow and deny. Now, combining all these three policies, you can play a very comprehensive defensive desk to protect your organizational resources. Now with that, you know, we got a good overview of the identity-centric access policies available in Google Cloud. Let's take a quick demo, and let me just orient you guys. Here you are as an administrator, set up a primary directory. It is cloud identity. You allocate your resources in a Google resource hierarchy across folders and projects. Everything is good. Your company decides to partner with another company to provide analytic services to all your employees. They happen to use Okta. You can easily use a federated identity to get them in a syncless mode in a few hours. And after that, individual project owners can give access to employees of this company called byoid.com, give them access to resources so that they can do their job. A few months later, there's a change in governance policy, and your company no longer wants to allow access to certain sensitive data to this contracting company. Now, if you're an admin, chasing down individual project owners and making them change their allow policy could be a very long process, if not impossible, in a large organization. Now, let's see in this demo how we can use a combination of BYOID and deny to access this scenario. Takes some time to replicate a policy, so I'm going to run a video and talk over it. Let's roll the video here. All right, so here I have, as an admin, I log into Google Cloud Console. Just take a quick look. I'm the admin of this process here. And the workload, the federated identity has already been set up. You can take a look here. You can come back, look at the configuration anytime. Let's look at this one, but set up. You can see they've used Okta. All the details are here, including the sign-in URLs. This is all preset as an admin. Now, let's go to the next step here. I want to give access now to these identities in my organization. I go to IAM admin page. You can find all the permissions here. Let's look at the principal set. And you can see we have given them, you know, browser and storage admin access because we want these guys to access storage. Now, let's log in as a vendor employee. Go there, you get prompted on an Okta, you sign in there, and you are redirected to Google Cloud. Let's go and see what access do I have as an employee from this vendor. I go to cloud storage, and you can see all the buckets that I have access to. These are the storage buckets. Let's click on a few. You see all the details, the files and the folders you can access. Click on another one. Yes, I have access that I need to do my job. And now comes this time where I need to now restrict access to these people as an admin. And this is done in two steps. First, let's write a deny policy. Here's the JSON file. You can look at it, as we talked about. Here are the principles. I put all the principles in the principles that we just showed, storage APIs, and deny permission when the sensitivity tag is set to high. And I go deploy this policy. Everything is good. Now, there is no effect yet because I haven't tagged the resources. Now, I go back. And I find out the two folders, you know, I want to tag them. Let's go there, the tags are created. I say sensitivity, give it high. And by the way, you can do it anytime, not at this time. In future, you can tag folders and the policy will take effect. All right, I have tagged those things. Now, let's see what happens. Let's refresh this and click on the client data. And you can see the policy has taken effect. You don't need to chase down your admins, your project owners to go modify the allowed policy. They can continue to do their job, and you as an admin can enforce governance using this deny policy. I hope that gives you an idea how you can use this hand in hand to protect your resources. Now, let's go back to the same diagram and talk about some other components that we have here. With the growing adoption of cloud technologies over the past few years, we have seen a manifold increase in identities. Some of the organizations we work in have seen even 10x increase in an identity. And now these users need permissions to do their job, which means there is an explosion of permission grants that has happened. And over time, that results to over-permissioning, which increases the threat vector, and it gets impossible to manage all of these things without help. That enforces the need for a principle of least privilege, easier said than done without a help there. So we are introducing two additional services in this Google Cloud called PAM and KIM that I will quickly show now. All right, so cloud infrastructure entitlement management, I'll call as KIM. It allows you to set the right permissions on your identities. You can see on the right side how over time, you know, you grant permissions. As per a Gartner report, 95% of the users use only 3% of the permissions granted to them. You can imagine the rest 97% creates such a huge threat vector. Now we need to contain this, and KIM does it, you know, by going through, helping you. First thing is to discover who has access, who is the risky identity. KIM does this by analyzing the data behind the scenes, gets you recommendations by this analysis and certain machine learning algorithms behind the scene, to set up the optimal roles. Changing those permissions could be tedious. It ties with Chronicle and gives you playbook to execute exactly the steps that are needed to remediate the situation. And it works with not just Google identities, but we will also support Entra IDs and Okta, which means even you can use this permission management for your third-party identity. We are launching this in preview in a couple of weeks. We will be supporting not just GCP, but also AWS. And by end of the year, it should work for Azure as well. Next, while KIM allows you to set up the access permissions at admin time, at runtime, there will be situations where your users will need some permissions in the last minute. It could be your on-call folks who need to debug an issue. It could be a service account which needs to do a routine task. or could even be some user who needs to access sensitive data, say your company financials for an investor meeting. You cannot give them perpetual access for these things. And that's where privilege access management comes in. This is a managed service which lets you manage and audit privilege accesses that you can grant just in time. It's a very simple workflow. As an admin, you create entitlement, which are like licenses or permissions that you want to give to certain users. As a user, you can discover what you're entitled to. You don't have access, but you're entitled to. You can go to the IAM page, click on it, and request a permission for a given period of time. Depending on the permission, it could be a self-evaluation or it could be a request workflow. If it is an approval workflow, sorry, it goes to the approver, the allow or deny as the case may be, and then you can access the resources for a few time. After the expiry of time, the permission is revoked, bringing you back into the secure posture. And once again, as we talked earlier, this supports all identities, including Google Cloud, as well as the federated identities. So that gives you an idea of, you know, how we are taking the identity and policy hand in hand and support not just Google, but also the federated identities. With this, I would like to invite our friends from L'Oreal, who have flown from Paris, to talk to you guys about some of these technologies, how they are using it in their environment, and some of the live examples. Over to you, Matthew.
Thank you so much. First of all, hi everyone. Not an easy moment, probably 8:30. Let's try to energize more and more this session with some L'Oreal stuff before deep diving. And again, sorry, I forgot my cloud shoes. Second session, second time. So let's start. As presented, I'm Mathieu Burel. I'm head of analytics and data visualization at L'Oreal. I'm really pleased to be with you to share our passion, not only for beauty, but also for tech. At 8:30, you may wonder why we are discussing about beauty here at Google Next Las Vegas. For those who follow the keynote of Nicolas Hieronymus, L'Oreal CEO, during the last CES 2024, here again at Las Vegas, you won't be surprised to know that at L'Oreal, we strongly believe that tech can push the boundaries of what's possible to improve the lives of our customers and to cater the infinite diversity of beauty needs and aspiration. And if we are today the first beauty company in the world, if we are today the leader of beauty tech, it's because over a century, we never stop innovating. At L'Oreal, we used to promise beauty for all, and thanks to tech, we want to offer beauty for each.
Beauty is an essential human need, and for more than a century, our sole dedication. At L'Oreal, we have always seen technology as a driving force to embrace beauty's infinite diversity. We are entering a new era where ultra-personalization is the new aspiration, where beauty for each is powered by beauty tech. Beauty tech is essential to know consumers intimately. By connecting 115 years of unique expertise and data, we understand consumers' needs like never before. Beauty tech is essential to astonish consumers with trailblazing innovations. By combining advanced science with game-changing technologies, we open new possibilities for unequaled beauty innovations. Beauty tech is essential to empower consumers with elevated beauty experiences. By imagining services that guide, diagnose, predict, treat, and coach, we build lifelong value for consumers. Beauty tech is essential to augment beauty consumers' journeys. By harnessing the power of tech, data, AI, and generative AI, we create new codes of beauty and new relationships between our brands and consumers. Beauty for each, powered by beauty tech.
Okay, are you feeling the energy? Okay, so after a century, a full century dedicated to the beauty. We are also proud at L'Oréal to have the world's richest database considering all aspects of the beauty tech data platform. 100 petabytes connecting with all our customers across the 37 international brands, across all divisions and categories, supporting all kinds of needs from science to AI through BI, and those thanks to an amazing network of 8,000 tech data and digital engineers. And we energized our beauty tech data platform with, of course, Google Cloud, and at the heart of Google Cloud, BigQuery. Okay, that seems to be cool. Everything happens well. We have Google Cloud that supports us. But the thing is, we want openness. The story of the beauty tech, even if it's in 2018, IT didn't start in 2018 at L'Oréal. And so what we are expecting from the Google Cloud platform is openness to bridge giants, to connect any kind of analytics that we can have at L'Oréal with Google Cloud for a seamless integration. So let's deep dive in the concrete stuff. Our analytics strategy is based on four key pillars. They are mandatory. First thing, no data duplication, unsustainable by definition. We want something secured, applying the zero trust pattern and the access management. We want something powerful, leveraging, of course, BigQuery for power and efficiency. And last but not least, everything could be possible with a live connection in order to be always up to date and to provide real-time or near real-time results to our business. Now, let's deep dive in the tech, and I will call my partner in crime, El Hadi.
Thank you, Mathieu. Good morning, everyone. By three key elements. The first one is zero trust, so all users are authenticated and authorized before accessing the data. The second one is the access management, so access control are managed in a single location and distributed for application. And the third one, row level security, accessing data in a specific row is restricted by user condition, providing a granular control, ensuring that user access is limited to authorized data. So this element collectively establish a secure analytic platform that meets our requirements. So to expose the data securely to our business user, we need to build authorized data layer. This layer is based on some key pillar. The first one is data. We need to identify the sensitive data that we want to protect, like consumer data or financial data. Second pillar is access management. The access rules are based on the user profile attributes, like country code, division, job function, to define a perimeter. This perimeter will determine which user have the necessary permission to access the data. Then we join data and access management table to ensure a proper data governance and security. Last but not least, the identity to secure data access. User access to data is limited within the scope of their perimeter. In this example, we used the attribute country to define the perimeter, and we can see that user one can only access data for country France, and user two can only access data for country US. All these elements and table are stored in our beauty tech data platform using BigQuery as single source of data trust. The access control is enforced through authorized view using user session to filter the data. This approach prevents unauthorized access data. So our objective is to provide securely data access to our business user to BigQuery using our analytic platform, Microsoft Power BI. This access must be direct query and also aligned with our strategic pillar, which is zero trust, access management, and row-level security. Initially, we use service account or AD technical account to connect Microsoft Power BI with BigQuery. This approach worked, but it raised some data governance and security concern, as it granted unauthorized access to all users in dashboard, and also BigQuery log do not provide any information about the user who is connected and accessed data. So to mitigate this concern, we use workflows identity to connect Microsoft Power BI with BigQuery. This eliminates the need of using service account or technical account, and also enable the user to connect to BigQuery using AD credential. We can summarize the flow between Azure AD and Workforce Identity Federation in three steps. First one, we retrieve Azure AD token. Second, we exchange to Google token using the secure token services. And third step, we use the Google token to call Google BigQuery. This is the flow which is seamless to the user. Workforce Identity Federation help us to meet our requirement. So we use it in our use case, and then we identify some improvement regarding the group access management. We worked with the Google team to add this feature to manage access to our project using Azure AD group. The flow is similar to the previous one with two additional steps between Azure AD Enterprise Application and Workforce Identity Federation to be able to retrieve Azure AD group of the user via Graph API and include this AD group in the Google token to be used to call the Google API. So to summarize, Workforce Identity Federation help us to meet our requirement. It's direct access. We meet our compliance and strategic pillar, zero trust, access management, and row-level security. So now let's move to a demo to show you how we use Workforce Identity Federation in our use case to connect Power BI with BigQuery. Back to you, Mathieu.
Thank you. Oh, demo time. So as explained, openness for us is equal to Workforce Identity. In this example, that's the case with Power BI, but it could happen with the other analytics platform. Okay, so that's the developer experience. The person will connect to Power BI desktop, then will select the BigQuery connector, the new one that is the link with the workforce identity. Of course, we provide the billing project ID, and we put it in direct query. We just authenticate, and as you can see with Microsoft, Azure AD authentication, and now I can access to the data. The first data set is just the raw data. The second one, as presented before by LAD, is the one with the user identity. Sorry, it's hidden because it's true data, but that's the UPN of the user. And the last one, it's with my own identity. I get the data, the raw data, but it's limited to my scope. That's why there is less rows. And now I can connect and start a normal user experience to design a dashboard in my analytics platform. And I can do it seamlessly and with the flawless user experience. It's fully integrated. I don't need to provide additional credential. It's normal for the user. The thing is, behind the scene, we fully leverage all the steps presented by LAD. And from a user perspective, so we have two web browsers open to the web version of our analytics platform. And as you can see, my user has a scope limited to USA and France. Perhaps you grab it from my accent. And my boss, don't ask me why, can just access to a smaller data than me. Normally, that's not normal situation, but it happened for the demo. The thing is, two distinct identities, nothing done by the developer in the analytics platform. We fully leverage the whole level security, the zero trust pattern, and the access management on BigQuery. And those thanks to the openness offered by Workforce Identity Federation. Last but not least, we can govern it, we can trace it, we can monitor it. As you can see on the top right corner, that's my identity that is provided. And so from a governance point of view and security point of view, we can track everything. Let's finish. Tech mantra at L'Oreal, secured by design, at scale, and seamless. That's the purpose of what we did with the great team of Google for the connectivity with our analytics platform, Power BI. But it's really a mantra for us. And thank you, everyone. I hope that I will have the same noise and the same clapping as in the other room. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, everyone. I hope we got a good glimpse of how open platform we are building, embracing the technologies around us. Unfortunately, we ran out of time. We are going to hang out in the room if you have any questions and you want to ask us. Here are a few related sessions on the same topic if you want to attend tomorrow. And once again, thank you very much for being here at Google Cloud Next and coming to our session. Thank you.